On August 4, 2017, the Republic of Rwanda held presidential elections. There were three candidates, including incumbent President Paul Kagame. On August 5th, the final results announced that President Paul Kagame won a third seven-year term with over 98% of the vote, leaving less than 2% to be shared between his two opponents. Government sources claimed the voter turnout was approximately 98%. The landslide win came as no shock to anyone in Rwanda or around the world. In July, during the campaigns, President Kagame even stated that the elections were just a formality. But opponents and rights advocates say his nearly 99% margin of victory reflect what they call an oppressive political environment that stifles dissent in the Central African nation, claiming that such results only occurred in oppressive regimes such as post-Saddam's Iraq and North Korea. One very vocal critic of the Rwandese government is 35-year-old Diana Rwigara, who wanted to become Rwanda's first female president. On May 2017, Diana Rwigara announced her candidacy, saying that people are tired and that people are angry. A few days after her announcement, fake news photos of her were released on social media. The government naturally denies any involvement. Her candidacy was later denied after the government claimed that she did not collect the minimum 600 signature requirement needed to run, even though her team claimed that they managed to collect more than 1,000 signatures for her candidacy. Another aspirant, Gibbon Mwendata, claimed that hotels in Kigali denied him rooms and conference areas to hold press conferences to announce his plans. In fact, he claimed that the only venue that permitted him to hold a press conference was a cemetery. And these are only two examples of political intimidation. With 17 years of rule already under his belt, President Paul Kagame was expected to step down after his mandate ends in 2017. However, in December 2015, Rwandans approved a constitutional amendment which maintains the two-term limit and reduces the presidential term limit from 7 years to 5 years. It also includes a crucial provision allowing the incumbent to first run for additional seven-year term, after which he'll be eligible to bid for two more five-year terms. This theoretically permits Kagame to remain in power until 2034. The amendment was approved by 98% of the voters. Officially, the president has stated that the idea of the constitutional amendment was actually a grassroots initiative, with a petition said to have been signed by over 60% of the voters. Many critics, however, argue that it is difficult to determine whether the petition actually represents the voters' free will or not. On previous occasions, President Kagame has stated that he does not wish to be president for life, claiming that it is the people who fear his resignation from power more than he does, leaving him a victim of his own success. There is no doubt that a huge percentage of the Rwandese people love and support their leader, and may even believe that he is the only one capable of leading their country into a prosperous future. The number could easily be in the high 90s. In this episode, we'll take an in-depth look at Rwanda, to understand this small nation's mindset and their obsession or devotion with their leader. I am Brian, and welcome to the Third World Report, where we give nothing but detailed facts, both pleasant and unpleasant, about every country in the world from a third world perspective. To understand any country and people, one must first look to the past. Countries don't just reach where they are by chance or by the snap of a finger, but through historical events which will affect them one way or another to this very day. Studies have shown that Rwanda's rich history goes as far back as 35,000 years into the Stone Age. The first known inhabitants of the area were the Twa, forest-dwelling pygmies or mainly hunters and gatherers. Later, between the 7th and 10th century, the Bantu-speaking Hutu people, who followed an agricultural way of life, settled in the region, probably from the region of the Congo Basin. Between the 14th and 15th century, the Tutsi, a pastoralist people of Nilotic origin, arrived from the north. Some sources claim as far north as Ethiopia, and formed a number of small and independent chiefdoms. It was probably not one large sudden invasion, but a slow process that was mostly peaceful. The Tutsis used the ownership of cattle and advanced combat skills to achieve economic, political, and social control over the Hutu. By the end of the 15th century, a few of these chiefdoms merged to form a state near Kigali, under the leadership of Ruganzu Bwimba I. In the 16th century, the Tutsi dynasty began a process of expansion that continued into the late 19th century, under the prominent Tutsi leader, Kigeri Rwabugiri IV. The Tutsi conquest initiated a process of political integration. The ownership of land was gradually transferred from the Hutu tribes to the Mami, the king of the Tutsis, who became the supreme head and absolute master of the country. A feudal social system based on caste, the conquering Tutsi and the subject Hutu was the dominant feature of the social relations, especially when it came to economic and political relations. The ownership of cattle, a vital element in the social system, was controlled by the Tutsis, who in turn parceled out their use to the Hutus. The Hutus did most of the farming and manual labor, but had little to no part in the government. However, to a certain extent, the castes were open up to each other. Intermarriage, especially between Tutsi males and Hutu females, was common. The Hutu language Kinyarwanda was eventually adopted by the Tutsis and became the national language. The first European known to have explored the region was John Hanning Speke, who traveled with Richard Burton to Lake Tanganyika in 1858 in search for the source of the Nile. When the Rwandan society was first described by Speke, it is assumed that the distinction between the Tutsi and Hutu is entirely racial, But this simple classification is blood by intermarriage and by the custom of allowing people to become honorary members of the other's groups. A more valid description of the Hutu-Tutsi divide is by class and occupation. In 1884 to 1885, after the Berlin Conference, the German zone of influence in East Africa was extended to include Rwanda and Burundi. In 1884, a German lieutenant, Count von Goetzen, apparently discovered Lake Kivu, yet people already living there. How impressive. On his way to Lake Kivu, he visited the court of the mummy, Kigeli IV Rwabugiri, in Nyanza, Rwanda. He was the first king in Rwanda's history to come into contact with Europeans. The next year, the mummy, Kigeli Rwabugiri IV, died. He's considered by many Rwandese as the last true king of Rwanda. With Rwanda in turmoil over the succession, the Germans moved in from Tanzania in 1897 to claim the region for the Kaiser. At the same time, they claimed Burundi, a separate kingdom to the south. Roman Catholic missionaries soon followed. The mummy submitted to German rule without resistance in 1899. German rule in this most inaccessible of colonies is indirect, achieved mainly by placing agents at the courts of the various local rulers. So the German influence is not yet extensive when the region is taken abruptly from their hands by Belgian forces from the Congo in 1916 during the First World War. With Belgium occupying the region, the League of Nations in 1923 awarded it the mandate known as Rwanda-Urundi. In 1925, an administrative union was formed between the Rwanda-Urundi mandate and the Belgian Congo, now the Democratic Republic of Congo, or DRC for short. A key policy of Belgian rule was the strengthening of effective control of the Tutsi dynasty throughout Rwanda, under Belgium's supervision, of course. Under the Belgians, colonial rule takes a very different form in the two territories. The administration of the Congo is centered in Brussels, but in Rwanda-Urundi, it is left in the hands of the Tutsi aristocracy, under Belgian supervision, of course. The Belgians, observing the distinctions between Tutsi and Hutu, make it the very basis of their colonial system. The Hutu are subject to the forced labor, which is common in many European colonies in Africa, but here, it is the Tutsis who supervise them at their tasks. From 1933, everyone in Rwanda-Urundi is issued with a racial identity card, defining them as Hutu, who are 85% of the population, Tutsi, who are 14% of the population, or Twa, who are 1% of the population. This Belgian attitude, setting in stone the distinctions between the two groups in favoring one of them, prepares the ground for future violence. In earlier times, even in the Tutsi-Hutu hierarchy in place, racially based massacres never occurred between them. FYI, the Belgians are the most ruthless colonials Africa or even the world has ever seen. Their mission in all their colonies was to divide the people along ethnic lines and destroy and rip. Belgium made no investments in Rwanda, or any of its other colonies for that matter. It preferred abusing, exploiting and massacring the people for their own personal gain, and using the colonies as their personal playground. Every country Belgium administered is still struggling with the effects of their turn-everyone-against-each-other style of rule. I will do a video about King Leopold and the Central African Holocaust in future. In 1946, after the end of the Second World War, Rwanda-Urundi became a UN Trust territory under Belgian administration. Events in Africa after the Second World War aroused Hutu political consciousness and led the Hutus to demand the abolition of the social and political inequalities. In 1957, Hutu leaders in Rwanda published a Hutu manifesto, preparing their supporters for a future political conflict to be conducted entirely on ethnic lines. In November 1959, the Hutu Revolution began, continuing sporadically for the next few years. Many Tutsis were either killed or fled to neighboring territories during the nationwide Anti-Tutsi campaign, named the Wind of Destruction. The 25-year-old hereditary ruler, Kigeli IV Ndahindurwa, was among the masses that fled. The Belgian authorities, along with the Roman Catholic missionaries, provided crucial support to the Hutus during this troubled period. A provisional government, Republican in tendency, and composed predominantly of the members of the Parlement-Hutu Party, Party of the Hutu Emancipation Movement, or Parti du Mouvement de l'Emancipation Hutu, was set up in Rwanda in October 1960. In the following January, the leaders of the Parlement-Hutu Party proclaimed the dissolution of the mummy and the creation of a republican regime. The new regime was recognized de facto by the administering authority, but the UN declared it to have been formed and established by irregular and unlawful means. On the 25th of September 1961, legislative elections and a referendum on retaining the institution and person of the mummy were held in Rwanda at the insistence of the UN General Assembly and under supervision of the UN Commission for Rwanda-Urundi. The elections gave the Parlement-Hutu, led by Gregoire Kayibanda, an overwhelming majority. In the referendum, an overwhelming majority voted to abolish the monarchy. The vote was 4-1 to abolish the monarchy. You have to remember, a majority of the population were Hutu. The UN strongly urged both Rwanda and Burundi to come into independence united, but reluctantly agreed that neither country wished to do so. On June 20, 1962, the UN General Assembly passed a resolution providing for the independent states of Rwanda and Burundi. And on the 1st of July, Rwanda became an independent country, with Gregoire Kayibanda as the first president. In the spirit of Kayibanda's movement, Korokoches became the favorite slang name for the Tutsis. The killing of cockroaches is soon an all too familiar feature of Rwandan life. In a frenzy whipped up by the government at any time of crisis, particularly whenever Rwandan exiles, most of them Tutsis, attempt invasion from across the borders. In December 1963, several hundred Tutsi guerrillas entered southern Rwanda from Burundi. They advanced to within 12 miles of the capital, Kigali, before they were eliminated by the Rwandan army. This event prompts the government to declare a state of emergency, emphasizing the need to clear the bush of subversive elements. Within days, approximately 12,000 mostly Tutsis are massacred in the southern province of Ginkongoro. In a coordinated campaign described by Bertrand Russell, a Nobel Prize winner, as the most horrible and systematic massacre since the Holocaust, it will prove minor compared to what will occur in the future. The massacre was a signal for a renewed exodus of Tutsi elements into the neighboring territories of Uganda, Tanzania, Burundi, and the DRC. In all, approximately 150,000 Tutsis fled between 1959 and 1964. In January 1964, the monetary and economic union that had existed between Rwanda and Burundi was terminated. Despite several economic difficulties, Gregoire Kayibanda was re-elected to a third four-year term as president in 1969. However, continuing internal unrest led the Rwandan army to overthrow the government in July 1973, and Major General Juvenal Habyarimana assumed the presidency. His regime, dominated by officers from the north, took a more moderate stance on the issue of Hutu-Tutsi relationships than had the previous administration. In 1975, he institutionalized his military regime, creating a one-party state under his National Revolutionary Movement for Development, or MRND for short. A system of ethnic quotas was introduced that formally limited the Tutsi minority to 14% of the position in the workplace and in the schools. During Habyarimana's 21 years in power, he received enthusiastic support from several Western countries, in particular France and Belgium. But his Hutu ethnic policies created an increasing problem on Rwanda's frontiers. Over the borders, there are a vast number of mainly Tutsi refugees, and as time passes, they're increasingly unwelcome in their host countries. Efforts are made to send them home, but Rwanda rejects them. The regime was corrupt and authoritarian, and popular discontent grew throughout the 1980s. In 1986, Habyarimana stated that as a matter of policy, there'd be no right of return for Rwanda's refugees. Eventually, in 1990 and 1991, the MRND agreed to allow partition competition, and several new parties emerged. But the greatest threat to the regime came in October 1990, when over 1,000 Tutsi refugees invaded Rwanda from Uganda. This group called themselves the Rwanda Patriotic Front, or RPF for short, of which the current president Paul Kagame was a leading part of. The nucleus of the RPF were Tutsi officers serving in the Ugandan army. On the prearranged date of October 1, 1990, they deserted from the army with their equipment and moved south over the border into Rwanda. It is a minor invasion, which eventually, against all odds, puts an end to Habyarimana's regime. But it also provokes one of the century's most appealing acts of genocide. President Habyarimana is able to repel the initial RPF invasion of northeastern Rwanda in October 1990, largely thanks to French, Belgian, and Zairean paratroopers sent for the purpose of defending the government. Government forces retaliated by massacring Tutsis. As this fire was worked out later in October, and Uganda, Burundi, and Zaire agreed to send in peacekeeping forces to supervise it. In November, Habyarimana announced that political parties would be permitted in 1991, and that ethnic identity cards he knew since colonial times would be abolished, of which he never did. In December, the country's most fervently racist tribal newspaper, Kangura, published the Hutu Ten Commandments. This is a litany of hatred, attributing dishonesty and treachery, not only to all Tutsis, but also to any Hutu befriends them. The Eighth Commandment, quoted at the time more often than any other, is Hutus must stop having masses on Tutsis. Fighting broke out again in January 1991. In March, further ceasefires were negotiated between government and Tutsi rebels in Brussels, but fighting continued. A name is coined for this new level of ethnic tribalism, Hutu power. To ensure the effectiveness of Hutu power, Habyarimana's regime begins to recruit Hutu youth militia. This became known as the Interahamwe, meaning those who attack together. In public, these violent young men run around on motorbikes, like any gang of hooligans, and hold drunken rallies under protest of President Habyarimana. In private, they gather together to perfect the skills of wielding machetes, setting fire to houses, and drawing up lists of local Tutsis and Hutu sympathizers. In this mode, ethnic violence increases steadily, and is often ratcheted up a sudden notch, as when in March 1992, Radio Rwanda spread a deliberately false rumor that a Tutsi plot to massacre Hutus had been discovered. By 1992, President Habyarimana, himself beginning to disappoint his extremist supporters, having failed to suppress the guerrillas of the RPF and under international pressure to come to terms with them, begins to negotiate. In April 1992, Habyarimana appointed an opposition politician, Dismas Nsengiaremi, as Prime Minister. The new cabinet included 9 members of the MRND and 10 opposition party members. However, their supporters still fought openly in the streets. By June, the government had officially recognized 15 opposition parties. Talks with Tutsi leaders continued on power sharing, but the Hutu-Tutsi division appeared to be beyond reconciliation. In August, the news that he was negotiating a ceasefire provokes a new wave of attacks on Tutsis. Over the next year, the peace process continues, alienating the president even further from the thugs of Hutu power. In August 1983, after talks in Arusha, Tanzania, Habyarimana signs a peace treaty with the RPF, officially bringing the war to an end, but the terms of the treaty go much further than that. In what becomes known as the Arusha Accords, Habyarimana accepts the rights of return for all Rwandese refugees, the merging of the RPF with the National Army, and a transitional period leading to elections and a democratic government. During this period, power will reside with a provisional government, in which, most startlingly of all, the RPF will be represented, and the UN forces will be invited into Rwanda to secure its process. However, unrest continued, and no transitional government, which the agreement called for, was established. In 1994, total breakdown occurred. In February, the Minister of Public Works was assassinated. His supporters, in turn, murdered an opposition politician. In April, a rocket downed the aeroplane carrying the presidents of Rwanda and Burundi. All aboard were killed. They were returning to Kigali from regional peace talks in Tanzania. From that point on, Rwanda became a killing field, as members of the Rwandan army and the Interahamwe massacred Tutsis and many more dead Hutus, including the Prime Minister at the time. Radio broadcasts asked people to do their duty and seek out Tutsis and Tutsi sympathizers living among them, in the streets or the villages. Eliminate the cockroaches was the message of the day. On April 29th, the state radio announced that May 5th is to be the cleanup day, by which the capital Kigali must be cleansed of all Tutsis. One notorious broadcast even suggested a necessary precaution in the interest of thoroughness, that unborn children should be ripped up from the wombs of the dead Tutsi women who are pregnant. In this atmosphere, the Interahamwe and a large portion of the ordinary Hutu population of Rwanda went to work with a frenzy probably unparalleled in human history. Between April and July, some 100,000 Rwandans are slaughtered, and this is without the modern aid of weapons of mass destruction. The characteristic tool in Rwanda's genocide is the everyday machete, normally used in agriculture. The terror of the 1984 is followed by another human disaster, as millions of refugees flee to Zaire, Burundi and Tanzania. But these are for the most part Hutus rather than Tutsis, trying to escape from the RPF, who resumed their military campaign the day after the assassination of the president. In the midst of the chaos, the RPF, capable of putting into the field an extremely well-disciplined guerrilla force, makes rapid progress against the Rwandan army. By July 1994, the RPF occupied over half the country, seizing Kigali and restoring some resemblance of order. When the international community was aware of the genocide occurring in Rwanda, little was done until the RPF had occupied a large part of the country. The UN approved a large expansion of the limited peacekeeping force in the area, as the RPF consolidated its control and established a government of national unity, headed by a Hutu president, Pastor Bizimungu. Major General Paul Kagame, the leader of the RPF, became Minister of Defense and Vice President, who was actually the one running the country. The government announced that Hutu refugees, numbering in their millions, were safe to return to Rwanda. But few believed them, and the conditions at the refugee camps, primarily in Zaire, began to deteriorate as disease and starvation became rampant. Though largely led by Tutsis, the RPF had been from the start committed to racial equality. This is achieved in the first cabinet, whose members reflected the numerical balance in the country. 16 of its members are Hutu, while 6 are Tutsis. But if the RPF government can rid itself of tribalism, this ideal proves much harder to achieve in the nation. Though an important first step is the abolishment of the ethnic identity cards in use since colonial times. A 70-member transitional national government was formed in late 1994, in the hopes of returning order to the country. In February 1995, the UN Security Council created the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda. Meanwhile, the government of Zaire's policy of forcible repatriation proved catastrophic as thousands of refugees died or disappeared. From April 1994 to 1997, some 100,000 Hutu refugees lost their lives, while the Interahamwe guerrillas were allowed to reign free in the camps. In Rwanda, almost 90,000 suspected killers were arrested and detained in miserable conditions, in whatever facilities the government could find, including soccer stadiums. The slow pace of the trials was a cause of considerable concern, but the UN and Rwandese authorities defended the thoroughness, offering it as evidence that the government was not interested in wholesale revenge. Of the nearly 90,000 prisoners, 1,946 had been indicted by 1997. A process of gachacha, trial by the local communities in which ordinary Rwandans charged their peers, began in June 2002 to speed up the trials of some 119,000 detainees. When it became clear to Rwanda that the refugee camps in Zaire had become little more than training camps for Hutu paramilitaries, Rwandan and Ugandan troops enlisted Zairean rebel leader Laurent Kabila to oust longtime dictator Mobutu Sese Seko. In less than 8 months, Mobutu was overthrown, and Kabila was made president of the Democratic Republic of Congo, formerly Zaire, in May 1997. A year later, Kagame and Yoweri Museveni of Uganda switched allegiance to support rebel forces trying to dispose of Kabila in the wake of the Congolese president's failure to expel extremist Hutu militias. This led to Africa's First World War, eventually involving 9 African countries. Peace talks in South Africa in 2002 resulted in a formal ceasefire, troop withdrawals, and a plan for transitional government in the DRC, to which Rwanda's proxy, the RCD Goma, was a signatory. By June 2003, with the backing of the UN troops, the transitional plan had commenced implementation, but fighting between Congolese soldiers, rebel groups, and Rwanda's proxy continued. In December 2001, a new flag and national anthem were unfurled to try and promote national unity and reconciliation. In April 2002, former President Pastor Bizimungu was arrested and faced trial on charges of illegal political activities, threats to state security, and possessing documents the government said advocated civil disobedience and ethnic division. He was held until 2004, when he was sentenced to 15 years in prison for embezzlement, inciting violence, and associating with criminals. He was released from jail 3 years into his 15-year sentence, after receiving a presidential pardon. Bizimungu's arrest was basically a purge by President Paul Kagame, who was consolidating his grip on power and eliminating all potential threats. On May 26th, the Rwandese people voted and approved a draft constitution by 93% of the vote. In June 2003, the new constitution, which bans the incitement of ethnic hatred, was signed into law, but international human and civil rights groups fear the constitution would limit multi-party pluralism and freedom of expression. In the same year, the first post-genocide presidential election and the first multi-party election since independence in 1962 were held. Paul Kagame won a landslide victory. He ran on a platform of increased justice, economic growth, national unity, and good governance. EU observers said polls were marred by irregularities and fraud. In March 2004, President Paul Kagame rejected a French report which said he ordered the 1994 attack on President Habyarimana's plane, which sparked the genocide. Relations with France begin to deteriorate from this point. The Rwandese government begins the mass release of 36,000 prisoners in July 2005. Most of them have confessed to involvement in the 1994 genocide. It is the third phase of release since 2003, part of the National Healing Program and an attempt to ease overcrowding in the prisons. In November 2006, Rwanda broke off diplomatic ties with France after a French judge issued an international arrest warrant for President Kagame, alleging he was involved in the bringing down of Habyarimana's plane. In December the same year, Father Athanase Seromba became the first Catholic priest to be convicted for involvement in the 1994 genocide. The International Criminal Tribunal sentenced him to life in prison. Approximately 8,000 prisoners accused of genocide are released in 2007. The number of suspects released since 2003 reaches 60,000. In August the next year, Rwanda accuses France of having played an active role in the genocide of 1994 and issues a report naming more than 30 senior French officials. The French responded by saying the claims are unacceptable. In elections the next month, President Paul Kagame's party, the RPF, won a large majority in parliamentary elections. In the same year, Rwanda officially decided that all education would be taught in English instead of French as a result of joining the English-speaking East African community. France sees this act as retaliation to its stance on Kagame's involvement in the genocide. In November 2009, Rwanda is admitted to the Commonwealth as the second country after Mozambique to be a member without British colonial past or constitutional ties to the UK. On the 29th of November, France and Rwanda also restored diplomatic relations 3 years after they were severed. In the same year, Rwanda is declared free of landmines. In February 2010, President Nicolas Sarkozy visited France to mark the two countries' reconciliation after years of mutual distrust over the genocide. In August, President Kagame secured his second presidential term with 93% of the vote. In June 2012, the Kachacha community courts were shut, 10 years after they were started, claiming they had fulfilled their intended purpose. In January 2016, President Kagame announced that he will stand for re-election in 2017, after winning an overwhelming majority in a December referendum on constitutional changes, allowing him to serve for a third term. In March 2017, Pope Francis asked for God's forgiveness for what he called the sins and failings of the Roman Catholic Church during the Rwandan genocide in 1994. On August 4th, President Kagame secured his third term as President of Rwanda in a landslide victory. After looking at all the historical facts, one can see that there are many factors that affect the Rwandese mindset, from colonization to the leaders after independence to the horrors of the genocide. With this knowledge, one is better equipped to understand the Rwandese mindset. President Kagame is definitely no saint, but in my opinion, once you take a look at Rwanda's past, one begins to better understand why and how the people of Rwanda put him on such a pedestal. This was a Third World Report by me, Brian. Be sure to like and subscribe to receive more in-depth and detailed videos on country histories and country profiles. Thank you for watching, and kwaheri.